Hello and welcome in, everyone. Today is day two of the inaugural Summer Institute of the UC Santa Cruz Center for Racial Justice. Day two is titled Revisiting the Writings and Legacy of Harry Chang, a Forgotten Theoretician of Race. I'm going to drop some links into the chat where you can register for day three tomorrow and find out more about the Summer Institute on the CRJ's website. For now, let me just tell you how this morning session is going to go. So this morning session is called Harry Chang on Race, Class, and Korea's National Liberation. It'll run for about 2 hours. We'll take a lunch break at 12 p.m. and reconvene at 1 o'clock for our afternoon session. And we're going to be using the same Zoom link for the afternoon session. So we'll soon hand over the time to our two speakers for this morning, Paul Liam and JT Takagi. Once our speakers are done talking and presenting, we'll open up for discussion. People will be able to unmute themselves and speak. And so I'll just say, to make discussion as smooth as possible, if you would like to unmute yourself and speak and contribute, we ask that you use the raise hand function in Zoom. It's under the reactions tab at the bottom of your screen. That way we can call on you one by one to speak. Otherwise, feel free to put questions as well in the Zoom chat. We'll be monitoring the chat, collecting questions, and we can read them out loud later. Okay, I will now give the floor to Christine Hong, the director of the Center for Racial Justice and our facilitator for this morning, to introduce the session and our participants. Christine.
Thanks so much, Stefan. Stefan, did you just want to say a word about what people should do at the break? You know, if they want to continue on for the second session.
Okay, so we're on the same Zoom link for the afternoon session at 12 o'clock. We just asked that if you want to jump off and jump back on, that would be ideal. So go off at 12, come back at 1, because the CRJ team will be remaining on here. Otherwise, if you're still on, we just ask that you turn your cameras off and we might put you back in the waiting room where you just were before you came in.
Okay, thank you so much. Good morning, everyone. I'd like to welcome you to day two of the inaugural Summer Institute of the Center for Racial Justice. And I wanted to open again by thanking the CRJ team and to acknowledge the enormous labor and commitment that went into mounting this particular launch event. So I want to thank Stefan. I want to thank Chiza Hughes as well. I want to thank Domingo Canizales, and I'd like to thank Taylor Ainsley. And I also wanted to say that, you know, and I mentioned this yesterday, that our hope for the Summer Institute is to keep this free and open to the public, accessible. We hope to hold this every other year, so not next summer, but the summer after. And right now, I also wanted to say that it's really thanks to funding from outside sources and some internal as well that we were able to mount this. So I'd like to thank the Peggy and Jack Baskin Foundation, the UC Humanities Research Institute, and the Student Fee Advisory Committee, which helped us cover our core operational costs. I also can see just from the names of participants that we are among longtime friends. And you know, feel free, should you wish to turn on your camera. We kept this in meeting format to be able to create that sense of intimacy. So I just wanted to say a little bit before handing it over to JT and Paul, and you know, to say a little bit about the Summer Institute. The hope for us in creating this kind of space is that the Summer Institute might serve as a site of convergence for political study, in this case, virtually mediated and but facilitated by people who have been long embedded in and emerge from movement spaces in which political education has been inextricable from praxis. And even though this is just a three-day summer institute and therefore it's necessarily more of a toe dip than a deep dive, I want to note that if you have registered for all 3 days, if you've been taking part, there are materials here for further study and inquiry. And it's our hope too that there will be a kind of fertile cross-pollination over the course of the 3 days. And we hope and we invite you to draw lines of continuity, to carry over critique from one conversation to the next. So today, the second day of the Summer Institute focuses on the writings and the legacies of Harry Chung, whose 1970s theorizations of racism through a Marxist lens had really far-reaching yet vastly under-recognized influence, shaping the arenas of critical race theory, ethnic studies, as well as anti-imperialist community-based organizing. And you know, for those of you who are Asian Americanists who are here, you will recognize that there was a portrait of Harry in Karen Tae Yamashita's I Hotel. She calls Harry Chung Carl Kung, somewhat fittingly. But I think that one of the questions that we had was why retrieve Harry? And I would just say that you could tell from the readings that you went through for today that he had extraordinarily provocative yet very clarifying insights on race. Clarifying in no small part because his insights were non-commonsensical. And I think that there's something very interesting about Harry Chung being a South Korean immigrant coming to the United States, coming in the 50s, being here through the 60s, and being something somewhat of an outsider to the social scene as it was unfolding, and having, therefore, very interesting insights. And so I think that, you know, this is also a moment just to ask, to go back to the question of why retrieve Harry, in which the dangers of what Harry described as the obfuscation of real relations of racism can't be discounted. And if you stay on for this afternoon's set of presentations, I think that the speakers will cover that. So I just wanted to say that just to go to the introductions, so Paul Lim and JT, as well as Eric Montague, who's in the house right now, they all met Harry at Antioch College in 1972. And Harry Chung was teaching courses on imperialism, Marx's capital, race and class, as well as early Asian American studies. He returned to the Bay Area in 1973, where he continued these study groups on capital. He passed away in 1979. Lim is the beneficiary of Chung's writings, including unpublished essays and notes on US capitalist development, including racial categories and race and class, and on reading Capital. With other friends of Chung, including Eric, he's developing an online collection of Chung's work. Paul Lim has long been active on Korea peace and reunification issues. Indeed, for the past 4 decades, he has visited North Korea in 3 different decades. He chairs the board of directors of the Korea Policy Institute. And I guess, thank you, Stefan. Stefan just put a link to KPI in the chat. JT Takagi is an award-winning filmmaker, a sound engineer, and an educator. She's also the ED of Third World Newsreel, an alternative media and center that nurtures and promotes media by and about BIPOC communities and social justice issues through distribution, exhibition, production, and training. Her own films, We're familiar with many of JT's films, focus on Asia, Asian American, and immigrant issues, and include four national PBS airings. JT teaches at the City College of New York and the School of Visual Arts MFA Social Documentary Program. And she has sound recording credits on numerous PBS and independent films. She serves on the boards of the New York-based Nodutto for Korean Community Development, as well as KPI. And so I will hand things over to Paul and JT.
I guess I'm going first. Welcome, everyone. I want to thank you all for joining us on Zoom today. And I want to thank the Center for Racial Justice for including a day on Harry Chung and for all 3 days of the seminar. Yesterday was a great PE workshop, and it leads us in some ways to today's. I'm pleased to be here to talk about Harry and his influence. He was an extraordinary scholar and generous teacher, but before today, you might not have ever heard of this Korean immigrant political intellectual. Stefan, thank you. I met Harry as a student in 1972, and now the screen, I can't see my notes, so you have to wait a second. When he came to Antioch College, he had been recruited to teach for the Institute for the Solution of Social Problems, called ISSP, as an assistant professor of Asian and Asian American Studies by some of the Asian American students like Pauline here, Leonard Hoshijo, Raisha Rocky, Songchi Lin, and others who had formed an Asian American collective. These students, by the way, not only went about recruiting a teacher, but also had been recruiting Asian students. My presence at Antioch was in part through their recruitment effort, though frankly, I mostly wanted to come because Antioch had no grades and offered good scholarships. Harry only taught at Antioch from 72 to 73, and it was his only full-time gig as a professor. But his influence on myself and other students, as well as others he's worked with before and after that time, was immense. I'll get into that, but first, let me tell you a little bit about Harry's life. Born in 1934 in Manchuria to Korean parents, his family moved to Seoul, South Korea in 1946 after the liberation of Korea from Japanese occupation and the division of Korea by the US and during the political and physical fighting that led to the official establishment of North and South Korea and then the Korean War of 1950. His father, we understand, was a principal of a high school. Harry was in school during that war and even studied 2 years at Yonsei University, and he then emigrated to the US right after the war in 1954 when he was 20. Harry attended UCLA in 1956, and by 1958, he was studying outside of class about Chinese communism. He got his BA in mathematics in 1960, and at the same time, he was studying Korean left-wing national movements. His official field was mathematics, and he ended up ABD, all but dissertation, at the University of Washington in Seattle. He was already leading study groups in Seattle on racism and imperialism and was active with the Black student movement. He came to the Bay Area around 1969 and was active with the Political Education Committee of the Bay Area chapter of the Venceremos Brigade, the solidarity group for the Cuban Revolution, where he began developing notes on racism and imperialism for the Brigadistas. So he was clearly a committed anti-imperialist and anti-racist and a student of Marx by the time he came to Antioch. When I was at Antioch in 1972, I was a somewhat confused Asian American who only knew some basic things, that the Black Panthers and Young Lords groups were demanding changes that Asian Americans needed to be part of, that we were Asian Americans and not Asians, that the Vietnam War had to end, and that I was going to become a doctor or something scientific. Harry Chung, as well as the Asian American students I met there, many who became my lifelong friends, were to me a strange group of people. Harry looked like a beatnik Korean, had a beret, and they all wanted to meet and study all the time. But the studies we embarked on made me question much of what I thought I knew or understood about why things happened in history and society. When I was growing up, nothing made sense, and my high school teachers would say that somehow everything happened in cycles and that all progress was due to the American system of democracy and capitalism. Marx and communism were just words to me. This would all change once we embarked on studying with Harry. Among the things we did with him was work on an Asian American history booklet, which is really just a pamphlet, but it made us have to research for information at a time, pre-internet, pre all the books that now exist, in order to have material for the course. At the same time, he taught courses in political economy of underdevelopment and reading Marx's Capital. He lived with Paul and others in a house in Yellow Springs at 604 Livermore, which became a hub for Asian American and other third world students, which is what we called BIPOC folks back then, who would study or just talk with Harry. He also started drafting his developing ideas on racism and racial categories in light of his study of Marx and Hegel. Harry said that his time at Antioch was exactly for that, for the chance to spend time studying with an eye to returning to the Bay Area, where there was a lot of political activity going on that he wanted to be part of. He returned to the Bay Area after Antioch to work as a computer programmer while continuing to write and study and leading study groups on Capital, including Volume 3 and the Gundrisa. The Capital notes he developed for the study groups were based on what he wrote for the Antioch students in his Reading Capital course. I participated in one of those Capital study groups with him in the Bay. He collaborated with friends and comrades in a racism research project, which culminated in the publication of his Critique of the Black Nation thesis in 1975 as a monograph. He continued to write about racism, but those writings and his Capital reading notes that he had developed were never published. Tragically, he got sick and his life was cut short. He was diagnosed in 1978 with brain cancer and died almost exactly a year later on August 19th, 1979. Harry was not able to see any of his other work published, but in 1986, a collection of his writings edited by his former Antioch students and friends, Paul Leem and Eric Montague, was published as the article Towards a Marxist Theory of Racism in the Review of Radical Political Economics. And currently, Paul and Eric are working on Harry's archives, and Paul will talk about that. For me, though, I'm neither a scholar nor an academic. I work in social issue film, making them and work as a sound recordist on them and with Third World Newsreel. But Harry had an influence on myself and so many that helped to change the course of our lives. Having a way to examine the way things are and came to be, and seeing more clearly the categories of race and class, and how we've been so mistaught, these things made it also possible for each of us to think about why and how we can make a difference in all the things that we do, whether it's in social issue media, teaching others, writing, and organizing. Certainly, whatever else you take from these forums, I hope it's at least that, to rethink what you have been taught, to take the opportunity to study and re-examine our reality, and to think about what you're doing, what could be doing that helps to change that reality. And now Paul's gonna talk about the content of Harry's work in the sense of the papers that you were on, some of the papers you were given to read. And thanks for listening.
Thank you, JT, and thank you, Christine. And thank you again to the Summer Institute for inviting us, and also for devoting this a portion of the conference to Harry's work. Seeing those pictures, I guess if he were alive today, he would look like a really old man. But those photos are as I remember him, and I think of him looking like that as a useful exuberant individual, as if I were going to maybe see him later on for dinner or something like that. I guess that's a measure of how quickly time passes, but also just how important this person was. Anyhow, so when he passed away, at the time he passed away, he did not actually, was not actually working on a particular publication. He was doing more of his own studies of issues in US capitalism. He was thinking about his next capital study group, and he was beginning his to actually try to get a more demographic sense of the demography of the working class in the US. He was actually, I would say that, I mean, he was continuing his work on, you know, on capital and on trying to experiment with different ways of presenting his ideas on racial categories and race and class. But I would say that there's a lot of work that indicates that he was really also turning his attention to actual class analysis of US society and coming up with some very interesting clarifications. But in any case, we did reach out to see if we could find a publisher for Harry's work, and we did mail a selection of his writings in the, I don't know, 1980 or 81 to the Monthly Review, and they very quickly got back to us and very politely, you know, said that it's not something that they would publish, and that they felt that the their publication of Caste, Class, and Race by Oliver Cox was standing the test of time as a standard for an analysis of race. So that was a bit discouraging. Also, remembering that during this period of time, literally all the books on Cody's bookshelf, a very famous bookstore in Berkeley, that had previously been loaded with Marxist literature, writings by Marx as well as analysts, you know, completely disappeared. This may have something to do with the economic crisis in the country, the ascendance of Reagan and Reaganomics, and the scramble of a new generation of American youth for survival at that time. However, Neil Gatanga, who I see has logged on, had met a graduate student in Boston and who was working on putting together a special issue of On Racism of the Review of Radical Political Economy, which is the journal of the Union of Radical Political Economics. And if it were not for that connection, we probably would have not had any idea that this journal was being planned. So we saw this as an opportunity to at least place on the record the highlights of Harry's insights into racism, race and class, and so forth. And our main consideration, I worked on this with Eric. Our main consideration, our primary goal or end goal in the publication was to actually put the ideas out there in Harry's own writing. And so the article that was distributed to you for this conference is actually all of Harry's writing. And we did take some liberties of cut and pasting sections of different articles into two main articles that he had written. But even in that case, all the cut and paste are his writing. And we're happy to do that and grateful that the editors of the review inevitably, you know, allowed Harry to have that platform. But it was very difficult in terms I think if you read the articles, I mean, there is a lot in there that is difficult to grasp. And, you know, there was a lot of feedback from the editorial staff that, you know, it would be better if we took certain things out. But we were stubbornly, you know, left them in. But anyhow, it was published. We're very grateful that it is out there. Although I've never since heard from the editors since that time. In any case, I want to say that the mass of Harry's work are contained in about 8 boxes. And these are writings that for the most part are in his handwriting in pencil, you know, and some of them are rough drafts of articles and some of them are just fully written for self-clarification. He's experimenting. But if you look at the breadth of the work, even the scribbles on the piece of paper, you get not only an idea of what he was thinking in terms of the subject of his study, but you also have a picture of the man. And just how dedicated he was to his work. So Eric actually was doing some research and he found this open source online platform, which is designed to enable universities and scientific institutions to use as a repository for papers written by colleagues, by you know, professors and other institutions, as well as students. And we are in the process of taking some of his more well-known writings and housing them or inserting them into this repository. And you know, our hope is that by early next year, you know, we'll release the archive online so people can start, you know, certainly reading Harry's capital notes, some of the studies he did about capitalism, also his key writings on race and racism. But it will be an initial launch, and as time passes, we will be inserting more and more of his work. So with that said, I will turn to the papers that were put out there. So when I first started talking about well, I did a trial running with Eric and JT on what I wanted to present about Korea Road to Peaceful Unification, which is this booklet here. I think it was kind of a total flop. And I think one of the main criticisms was that, you know, people would want to hear what this all meant to me, you know, as a developing activist or whatever. And, you know, and normally I sort of like keep away from that. But I'll talk a little bit about myself and what meeting Harry actually meant in terms of my own life. And I see that my son has logged into this webinar, so with that in mind, maybe I'll learn a little bit about me that he didn't know already. So I'm a Korean American, second generation, and I think growing up for as long as I can remember, whenever the question came up in school or among friends, or what is Korea or where is Korea, you know, I felt like it was my responsibility to let them know. Not that I particularly wanted to play that role, but it was sort of like, what are you going to do? Nobody knows what Korea is. You're the only one that does, so you have to speak up. I think I also felt a certain privilege in my knowledge about Korean and Korean affairs due to my parents. They both were active in the Korean independence movement during the period of Korea's colonial rule by Japan. And later on, my father was, for a short period of time, represented South Korea in the United Nations as its ambassador. And so it's like in 1960, and shortly thereafter, he resigned his position in protest of the military coup of Park Chung-hee, and was active for the rest of his life in the overseas movement for reunification and democracy. But the other spread, I think, of my development, and I would have to say a more passionate interest of mine, really had to do with coming of age in the late 1960s. And I would say the major influences were probably the civil rights movement, reading anything I could get my hand on about, you know, the Black Liberation Movement, Malcolm X, you know, what we all did, those of us who have gray hair on this webinar. Except for JT, she doesn't have any, she didn't have any gray hair. And then also by the time I got into high school, you know, the war in Vietnam was raging. And so the, you know, and I came to Antioch with a very definite anti-imperialist bent. And I say, you know, an interest in learning about the national liberation movements for socialism around the world. And so I would say that that was the influences on my life occurring domestically in the United States were probably more exciting to me than what was going on in Korea. So I think, like, with Korea and the Korean issue, I sort of had a love-hate relationship. And the love part was, you know, I did feel a sense of patriotism when it came to, like, you know, stating very clearly that Korea is a country with its own history, it's not an appendage of Japan, and so on and so forth. But at a very personal level, you know, I grew up outside of the Korean community, and the set of Koreans that I came to know outside of my immediate family, which I don't think I knew any Koreans outside of my immediate family, these were mostly politicians from South Korea that came to the United States. And they would visit us in our home, and they would essentially ask my father for connections they could make with important American officials or diplomats or congresspeople, actually solely for the purpose that they could meet them, get a photograph taken of them with these celebrities, go back to South Korea, and with that photo show just how well they were connected to the great, you know, US benefactor, and get elected for office, whether locally or on the provincial level. I mean, even to my parents, it was a very, you know, disparaging scene. And it is essentially, I think, what I came to understand, you know, colonial mentality that is really repugnant. It's well, I won't go into Korean history, but you know, this sense, particularly in South Korea and in pre-colonial Korea, where you know Korean sovereignty was seen as not being possible without the benefactor of a great power, whether that be China, Japan, Russia, or the United States, you know, ultimately led to factionalism of the court and the downfall, you know, of Korea to colonialism. So this is the part where I get choked up because fortuitously, not only was Harry probably the first adult Korean that I ever befriended, but he was an adult Korean man who came to this country actually at the age of 20, you know, that his thinking was fully formed, you know, by being Korean. And yet this man had no, no trace of colonial mentality. So I think that, you know, while I had been studying national liberation and socialism at Antioch before and after I met him, the meeting of Harry to me personally it gave me a sense of what national liberation and the anti-colonial movement must mean. So all those people out there in the world you know, who have been suffering under the weight of US imperialism. So I think that it's ceased to be kind of an intellectual interest, but actually very shocking awakening for me personally. So, okay, so anyhow, I put that aside. I also want to say that, you know, I'm very happy that this aspect of Harry's work on Korea is part of a conference in which friends and colleagues of mine will tomorrow be launching a very exciting liberatory study to end the Korean War, and my longtime friend and comrade Ji-Yun will be doing a study or haksa for radical peace, and I'm sure she will be touching on Korea. With that said, looking at this particular book, in 1970, when I went to Antioch, you know, I of course went to the library to see what was on the bookshelves for Korea, and really, there are only two books I could find that were not just totally produced by Cold War scholars. And these two books actually, the reason why they were valuable to me is that they were actually written in 1944 and in 1950, you know, prior actually to the, you know, to the, what do you call it, the workshop of anti-communist propaganda that was being put out by US academics. And so to me, those works were pretty refreshing, but at the same time, they were very old. I'll just cite the authors, George McCune and Andrei Grishtanzev, who I actually know next to nothing about, except having read their books. Although I had been reading about Cuba, about Vietnam, and of course about China, I really knew next to nothing about the Korean Revolution. And I actually didn't think there was a Korean Revolution, because the prevailing thought in those days were that Kim Il-sung, a young man at the time of liberation, I think in his early 30s, much like his grandson, was actually an imposter, and that the true Kim Il-sung was an older man who led the guerrilla struggle in Manchuria, and that he died, and there's this younger person who was selected by the Soviet Union as a puppet, sort of like assumed as an imposter the identity of this older person. That essentially, you know, was the story on the Korean Revolution. So, you know, when I met Harry, you know, and I actually learned for the first time that, well, you know, six years before land reform in China, North Korea had carried out the first successful land reform in Asia. There is a clarion call that is often attributed to Mao, in which Mao says, you know, let those who have strength give strength, those who have knowledge give knowledge, you know, and those who have money give money, and together let's work to build a new society. That actually was actually a clarion call put to the people of North Korea in 1946. And just after the liberation from Japan. So all these things that I had never known about North Korea, I probably would not have really been able to learn or study without Harry. But the most important thing, I think, what distinguished Harry from other Korean nationals or conservative-minded nationalists that I met as a younger person is that his concept of Korea's place in global movements for national liberation was essentially to say that as Koreans, by virtue of what they are doing, that they are building a socialist society, that they have their own position at the front line of that struggle, and that if you look at the geopolitical landscape of the Korean Peninsula, it's very easy to see that North Korea sits there, you know, on the borders of China and Russia and Japan, and is actually performing a role as a buffer, you know, against encroachment by foreign forces upon the Soviet Union and Japan. Soviet Union and China, and this is a role that the North Koreans were very proud to play. So when I hear this criticism of North Korea as having been the beneficiary of cheap oil prices from China and Russia, I sort of bristle, because what is the cost what cost have they paid in order to hold the front line of national liberation on the Korean Peninsula? I also want to say that the other remarkable thing about Harry is I didn't feel like I had to be to Koreanize myself in order to have a conversation or to become a friend. I didn't have to explain to him why I didn't speak Korean. And why I didn't know how to use chopsticks and all these, so I know how to use chopsticks now and all these sorts of things. And it was really because Harry, you know, who had come to this country in 1954, you know, even as an adult, amazingly acculturated himself to this society. And his outlook was extraordinarily international. He had this a sense of both Korea and US and their places in world history at a given moment. He also had international taste in terms of his own demeanor, his facial expressions to a certain extent, his taste and so forth. But I think what with all of that, you know, what is what we all remember from living with Harry at Antioch is that for all his talk about the world's worldwide struggle against imperialism and so forth, you know, every month almost we would, a couple of us would have to get into a car and drive to New York City, go to Chinatown, buy as much kimchi as we could and bring it back to Antioch. And, you know, actually my friend John Takakua and I risked our lives on one of those missions in the middle of winter. And the car broke down. We didn't get back for about a week and people thought that something bad had happened to us, but we came back with the kimchi. I wanted to just share with you one paragraph of this booklet. This is just to give you an idea of this is shocking that a Korean would write something like this. To my mind in 1972, I don't think there were any Koreans outside of Korea other than Harry that would have ever written something like this or believed in something like this. And it just sort of blew my mind. I had never heard of Korean reunification being discussed in this manner. So I just wanted to share this with you. he writes, the reunification proposal of the DPRK, North Korea, is based on the explicit distinction between one, expelling US imperialism from South Korea, and two, the task of reunification itself. This distinction to those whose thinking has long been conditioned by such categories of imperialist political science as spheres of influence, geopolitics, and big power arrangements, etc. But this distinction is of the utmost importance if we are to see that the decline of imperialism corresponds with the simultaneous rise of national liberation and popular democracy. The present worldwide sorry for that misspelling. I typed this in this morning. Upheavals, disintegration, come reconstruction. It is only the reactionary, the moribund, who see doom and chaos ahead, and this forces them even more into the brace of outworn categories. So, if you look at the situation of Korea and other South Korea and other countries that are relying on US patronage in Asia, what they are facing in their own mind, you know, I think could be described as seeing doom and chaos ahead. The question is, for someone like the newly elected president, Yoon Suk-yeol, you know, is this a circumstance of Korea in the emergent Cold War in Asia? Is this circumstance is going to lead this new president and his administration to seek out a new path for finding a way of navigating itself through this new geopolitical arrangement without, while not subjecting Korea to another war, while at the same time enabling the government to uplift the working conditions and standard of living of its population. will it go that path of seeking a new path of development going forward? Or will it retreat into, essentially, will it retreat into the decades old US-ROC security alliance, not only retreat into it, but entrench themselves in it and aggressively try to breathe life into that security arrangement? And that security arrangement actually makes the United States and South Korea military allies. So what would happen, you know, if we end up in a war with China? Is the United States going to spare its Korean ally from joining the fray? You know, we know that in the case of Vietnam, South Korea sent troops to fight against the National Liberation Forces in Vietnam. We know as recently as last week, Vietnamese citizens are coming forward and testifying in South Korean courts to war atrocities committed by those forces. So is this what we're looking at today? I think, you know, it is, you know, to Harry's credit and to his foresight that, you know, 50 years ago, literally 50 years ago, you know, he's describing a situation that has been, he described a situation that has been consistently present over the years. And one may say, well, 50 years ago when Harry was writing, how come it didn't happen back then? But those of you who are my age and you look back 50 years, I think you will agree that they went like that. 50 years in, you know, as a period of time in world history is a blink in the eye. And, you know, I have to say that, you know, I feel very fortunate to have had this insight, you know, in my youth, because it's actually this, you know, alignment of situation of a particular country with general situation in the world politically, you know, is something that I have been able to rely upon in terms of my own understanding of what's going on in the world today. So, okay, I wanted to share that with you. And I wanted to assure you that there's no one else that had this kind of a view on Korea's road to peaceful unification, at least that I know of. And members of my family, including my brother and my parents, had also met Harry before he passed away. And I think they were stunned. This remarkable person. Okay, so I wanted to go to the next slide. So this is this sentence is, appears in the first paragraph of this pamphlet. And I had not read this pamphlet for many, many years, maybe decades, until preparing for this the program this morning. And this really threw me. It says, the year 1971 was a fateful one. Even members of the US ruling circles had to admit that the Indochina war had turned into a total fiasco. This helped strain the capitalist international monetary system of Bretton Woods to a breaking point. And in August, it collapsed. So this is a book about Korea's road to peaceful reunification. And if you were to open up this book and read this in the first paragraph, at least when I did, I had to wonder what is it about, what does this have to do with anything? And how is it that Indochina had anything to do with Bretton Woods? I didn't even know what Bretton Woods was. Did the Viet Cong attack Bretton Woods? So what I wanted to do is, you know, just for fun, for those of you who are as old as I and those of you who did not live through this period, we're going to go into very short breakout just to sort of talk about what this might mean. And then we can come back and share a little bit.
Okay, so we'll move into breakout rooms and then I'll broadcast this passage that Paul just shared with us so you can see it in your rooms. And then we'll come back in 5 minutes or so. Okay, looks like we're all back, so I'll hand it back over to you, Paul. Paul, you're on mute.
So what do you all make of that? You know, maybe just feel free to chime in. Does it make any sense? I see gray hair out there. I know that some of you live through this.
I say yes, Paul. It made sense to me, but that's because I'm same age as you. And I told my group, I was just as befuddled and dumbfounded when I read that when I was young and a student as you were. It's only with a little bit of time, study, and experience in the passage of history that I can read it now and say, oh, I know what he's talking about. I understand. Exactly. So,
Sorry, Amy already raised their hand. Go ahead. I don't know who was talking. Go ahead. I was just going to explain in rote terms what other people in the group I was in explained to me that I just was totally unfamiliar with, which was JT Takagi, and I can't remember who's in the frame with Miriam, but sort of like talking about Bretton Woods is sort of the a period of time in which gold and money were actually connected in 71, signaling sort of the breakup of that. And also, I think the implication from Harry being that this was the downturn of capitalism, where this is like me as a filmmaking person trying to explain economics, but just in which like our belief in money is what keeps money happening.
Yeah, you got the golden money. That did break up, that did separate.
I hadn't heard of Bretton Woods before specifically.
You know, about 20 years.
Amy, I'm sorry, Amy also had her hand up.
So I was in a group and we also talked about how many of us had not heard of this at all. And I think what was really sobering is the kind of archival effort that has to be done now. The extraordinary labor that you're undertaking is absolutely incredible. And it's incredible that we are just accessing some of this really prescient, you know, knowledge that was there so long ago. And the fact that many of us who are actually in the field and some studying some of these topics in US academia are, you know, learning about this anew. And so this kind of retrieval work that you guys are doing, we're just so appreciative, but also thinking about the uphill battle that are still, you know, persistent today. A lot of it hasn't really changed. And we also talked about the discrepancy between the lack of knowledge on the one hand, the invisibility of certain aspects, and then the really hyper-visible you know, narratives like the defector narrative someone mentioned, for example. And we don't have the basic, you know, understanding of some of the key movements and people and you know, systems like the Bretton Woods systems. Not accidental. So
I think it's great to hear that this is something of interest and that you think is important. And you know, again, yeah, thank you for your sharing. Let's see, I'm trying to. Okay, I'm just trying, I lost my chat for some reason, I can't find it.
How do you raise a hand?
Okay, well, I got it back. Okay, so just so that we can move on, I think the, you know, in the mid 1960s, the US had two big line items in the budget. One was for the war on poverty. The other was for the war in Vietnam. And so that's more money that the United States had to spend. So American people, as far as I know, the American people, they're not out there to fund a war. That's not on the agenda. particularly to fund a war in a country that really no one even knew where it was on the map. so the war on poverty was for the most part funded by revenues, tax revenues. But when it came to funding the war in Vietnam, the US funded it by, with its debt. It started selling treasury bonds. And dollars were winding up in large amounts in central banks around the world and, you know, in every country that one had some extra money that they wanted to preserve as a value, the best deal was to purchase a U.S. Treasury bond because the U.S. dollar was so stable. But at the time, there had been a convention held at a hotel in Bretton Woods. Right up after after the war, and there was an agreement that the dollar would be pegged to gold at the rate of $35 per ounce of gold. And so this meant that for every dollar that was out there, the United States had to be able to give that entity gold in exchange if they wanted to exchange their dollars. So the war in Vietnam cost so much that at a certain point, there were more dollars out there than there was gold in Fort Knox. Okay, so in those days, if you were going to default, if the U.S. is going to default, it's not defaulting on interest payments or the amount of money due to service ongoing loans. The default is that, well, somebody comes to you and says, hey, I want, you know, $1 million of my gold back, and you go looking around Fort Knox and there's no gold there. That's default, meaning default during the days of Bretton Woods. So, you know, the United States, a ruling class has always been, you know, looked down its nose at the French. And I think one of those reasons why there's been that animosity between the two ruling classes is that de Gaulle, who was the president of France at the time, realized, hey, there's more dollars out there than the United States can finance. This is a train wreck. I have all these dollars. I want my gold. So he actually starts shipping, docking his ships in the ports of the United States. I don't know where, if it was in Texas or in the Treasury of New York, and shipping tons of gold back to France. And this is I think what Harry is saying, that the fiasco in Vietnam brought Bretton Woods to the breaking point. He said that the United States was overspent in terms of its military venture in Vietnam, and it didn't have the money to pay for it. So it took the dollar off the gold standard. And so at that point, it didn't have to give anybody, it didn't have to pay anybody gold for dollars. But the interesting thing is that dollars found another landing place to land, which was oil, you know, and the petrodollars. The United States made an agreement with Saudi Arabia. If you want to know why the United States, Biden is going back to Saudi Arabia on his knees to beg the Saudis for oil, it's that the agreement was is that the Saudis would denominate the price of oil in dollars in exchange for an agreement that the United States would be the military benefactor of Saudi Arabia in the Middle East. And Saudi Arabia would take those so-called petrodollars and recycle them back to purchasing US debt. So the US actually ended up with an unlimited source of funding for the war, not only the war in Vietnam, but for funding the war, the Cold War globally for the last 50 years. So we have all in the movement, you know, had this sense that, yeah, we're always at war, but you know, why is that? Because I don't know anybody, even the most conservative person, that really wants to spend all our money on a war. So how is something like that possible? Well, it's possible because the ruling circles, or whatever you want to call them, the deep state, the capitalist class, or whatever, they have an unlimited source of funding and they don't have to ask anybody for it. There's no accountability. If the White House says Treasury sell more bonds, even though the White House, the Treasury will. And the Federal Reserve and central banks around the world will buy them. And all these dollars, digital dollars, will be deposited back in the coffers of the US. And the only thing that this is not about the United States not being able to pay back that debt. It cannot. the debt is too big. But if the United States can service that debt, it's like a credit card. I mean, at one point in my life, I had like, I don't know, almost a year's worth of, you know, of money, of salary on my credit card. The only way I could survive is because every month I would pay the minimum payment, you know, a part of the principal and the rest of his interest. So that's actually, you know, what is going on. So I don't know. I know that Harry used to talk all the time about Bretton Woods and petrodollars, but, you know, back in the 70s, but you know, I think, I didn't know what was going on there. I didn't know why US imperialism wasn't collapsing. I didn't know why revolution wasn't happening in this country. And a lot of what was going on in this country, the bubble we have been living on, you know, has been funded by US debt. Anyhow, well, that said.
Paul, did you see that both Don has his hand up right now, and either Miriam or Belvin as well?
Am I the one that clicks on them?
I can, yes.
Yeah, hey, Paul, I just wondered as a footnote on that, De Gaulle animosity or jealousy towards the US was also related to the fact that France was the colonial power that withdrew from Vietnam.
Yeah.
And so that was another way to needle the US, is like, get the hell out of there.
Yeah, I just wanted to bring this back to Harry, because like, you have these difficult concepts. And one of the things that Harry did was to sort of break these concepts down into something we can understand. So he used the idea of a checkbook. And if you have no money in your checking account, it's still good. Your checks are still good, so long as everybody agrees that I'm not going to cash it in. The same thing as Paul's example of a credit card. You know, your credit is good so long as nobody calls you in to pay the bill. So Harry was good to take, you know, very complex concepts and break it down into things that we're actually, the layperson can actually understand. That's all I want to say.
I think also it's interesting that Paul, you chose this example, because in 1971, when the Bretton Woods thing was going up in smoke, is about the time that a bunch of 20-year-olds met Harry. So it's at this point of crisis in the U.S. capitalist system that we discovered him and he discovered us. And yeah, the rest is history.
Yeah, can I just jump in on one other thing about Harry making things simple for us? When I took his capital class, he really explained how capitalism ownership in the current world in the form of the stock market with all the money and ownership in the form of stocks was, he described that as a gambling, he described that as a gambling house system. And it's something that, you know, it helped me totally understand why it's so hard to personalize the capitalist class.
Vicky, did you want to speak as well? Can you unmute the bottom part of your screen, bottom left-hand corner?
Yes, hi. I don't know how to put a hand up, I'm sorry. But yeah, I was saying in our small group that I wanted to fill in a little bit more about Harry's background and history, because I was married to Harry for about 10 years. And we met, my father introduced us. Harry knew my father before he knew me, and had lots of discussions with my dad before I even met Harry. My dad was in the Communist Party, had been in the Communist Party about 20 years. So you know, this is the end of the 50s now when he meets Harry, and the McCarthy period is happening. So the communists are getting really you know, either killed in the case of a couple people, or kicked out of places. And many of the people in my family were communists, and they ended up leaving the Communist Party. My dad never left the Communist Party. He was really committed to it until he had a big heart attack and couldn't. So after he had that heart attack is when he met Harry, and they spent a lot of time talking together. So there was that friendship and that understanding that Harry was just a sponge. My father described him as a sponge and as somebody that could then take knowledge and just really simplify things so that people could understand it. The other thing is that then when I met him, we went to Seattle for him to have a job. When we went to Seattle, he met some Sudanese students who were from Southern Sudan. And the Sudan had was separated at that time. There was a northern and a southern. There was a revolutionary war going on in the Sudan at that time. My internet is unstable. Oh, well. Anyhow, bottom line is he created a study group around Marxism with those Sudanese students. So a lot of his development was always accompanied by groups of people helping him to actually identify issues, both national and international issues, and how to simplify them using the terms of Marxism-Leninism. So I just wanted to fill people in terms of that background. So.
Wow, thank you so much, Vicky. Yeah, Paul, go ahead.
Okay, shall we move on? Okay. Okay, I just figured out how to close the chat box. Okay, so it's actually 11:30. So this goes till noon, right? Okay. So one of the papers out there is called Philosophical Tidbits. So I'll leave that aside. And my only remark will be is that he started working on these tidbits when he was at Antioch. He came to Antioch. I don't think he ever intended to stay at Antioch. He always wanted to. His thinking was, I'm going to go there. I'm going to have some time for concentrated study of Marx and Hegel, be part of something exciting happening. But I want to be able to go back to the Bay Area because that's where things really are happening. That's where his friends were, his loved ones. That's where Vicky was. And he didn't like living in Ohio. So these philosophical tidbits and all the notes that he was using for his classes and at Antioch, he took back with him to the Bay Area. And eventually the philosophical tidbits winded up as the last chapter or segment in the capital notes he developed for his study groups in the Bay Area. So I'm just going to go quickly to, in 30 minutes, try to get to the core of this article. So I have to start by saying that Harry always framed a race like this. He would look at us and he would say, you know, race is racist. And then he would sit back and he'd say, and look for some kind of a reaction. And, you know, I think my reaction was, well, isn't that kind of a tautology? more recently, though, you know, I was reading, I haven't read Coates's entire book, Between the World and Me, but you know, a very famous quote from that book is, race is the child of racism, not the father. So I think Harry would agree with that. There is something that comes before race, you know, as if a father. And the question is, what is that father? And Harry posits that that racial categories, black and white, are categories of a distinction, which we know he calls after the fact or post facto racial. And that can sound a little bit mystical. So I have this very brief slideshow, which I think I can get through in, oh, you have that slide. Oh, I don't have to do that. That's very good. Okay, so Harry referred to this distinction as being particularizing. Okay. He talks a lot about particularization in a philosophical sense, but concretely in US history, this graphic that you're looking at, this is the particularization. It's a particularization of labor in colonial America. If you look at the left-hand side, before the mid-1600s, the labor force was a combination of indentured servants of European descent and African descent. Servitude was not always hereditary, and the possibility for freedom existed either through, skip to the last paragraph. The key thing is Africans labored and socialized alongside of white indentured servants. here's the particularization. So we, after relief, we go after the mid-1600s. At this point, slavery is legal in all of the colonies, which is an important point because English common law does not have a provision for slavery. Slavery is something that was created in law in the colonies. It's foundational to the legal system in the United States. More importantly, and this is the particularization, slavery was reserved for people of African descent. Laws were enacted to limit, prohibit interaction between white servants and black slaves. So racial categories as a particularization, you know, historically speaking, is a sorting out of the labor force in colonial America and deciding, you know, who in my workforce am I going to grant freedom at the end of their period of indenture? And who am I going to keep? Because I need, because I can't let you all go. You know, it's sort of a very practical decision in the mind of a planter or a small land holder or so forth. So let's go to the next slide. Okay, so today we all know about racially disparate treatment, but that's not something that's just happening today. It actually all began centuries ago. So this is a situation. This, by the way, is a portrait by the very, very famous artist, James Marshall. This John Punch was an indentured servitude, one of three indentured servants, the two other being white. The three of them, they skipped out of town to escape their indenture, and then they were caught and brought back. So in the court proceedings that followed, what happened was, you can guess what happened to the two white indentured servants. They were fined by adding, I don't know, 4 or 5 years on to their term of service. But for John Punch was enslaved for life. So there is their racially disparate treatment. And from what I am reading on the internet, this is the first documented case of an indentured servant being enslaved for life. And thanks to particularization, you know, this decision, for some reason, James didn't qualify for freedom. You know, so the notion of not, you know, a Black not carrying within themselves what we know to be the inherent human right for the pursuit of happiness and all that, that was not something that was a consideration for John Punch. Okay, next slide. I'm trying to keep my eye on the time. So this is very interesting, crucial. In English common law, you know, the status, the social status of the of social status of the next generation was determined by the social status on the father's side. So Elizabeth Key was born of an Englishman and an African woman, and nevertheless was kept in servitude. So she actually sued for her freedom, arguing that based on English common law, I am the offspring of a free English man, and therefore I should inherit his status. So English common law provides a loophole, escape hole, through which Africans kind of escape this fate of enslavement or being marked for indefinite servitude. So next slide. Okay, so here we're plugging that loophole. This is very interesting. It says, whereas some doubts have arisen, you know, if I read these things, we'll run out of time. So basically what happens is that Virginia passes a law in 1662, which says, you know, going forth, the offspring of this mixed parentage will inherit the status on the mother's side. Okay, so this is not English common law. This is purely Virginia. This is the United States. What this does is it legalizes rape because, or let me back up. This is the genesis of the one drop rule Harry calls hypodescent. Now, hypodescent is not an original idea of Harry. I mean, it's a generally known topic, but it means that if you have one drop of something, you become that something, even though the 99% of the rest of you may be something else. But this is legalized rape in the sense that what is happening is that white owners are raping their African or Black women servants. And so by default, you know, the offspring of these unions, you know, the question is, should they be free or do we want to keep them in servitude? So if we want to keep them in servitude, you know, we're going to have to confer the status of the mother on them. That's legalized rape, and it's also hypodescent. It's a this logic of hypodescent is something that Harry finds an analogy in pre-capitalist societies, the distinction between a legitimate heir and a bastard son. You know, that distinction was made as a way of disenfranchising a child born out of wedlock from the father's estate. So hypodescent historically emerges as a disenfranchising phenomenon, which is directed at the children of white. I always confuse how to say this, but you get the point, right? If your mother was African American and your father was white, you're still going to be enslaved. So that is hypodescent. The last point I want to make about hypodescent is that at a certain point in time, 1808, the importation of slaves into the colonies ends with the end of the slave trade. But at that point, the population of slaves in the United States almost triples. Part of that is, you know, the bulk of that is, you know, that there is a large population of African Americans or Black people who are, you know, are having children, you know, and these children are property of the masters, and those children and are being sent, purchased and sold to different parts of the South, but also the momentum to provide a source of slave labor was to take the children of white masters and assure that they also share the fate of slavery along with their mother. Next slide. Okay, here's another loophole in the sorting process or the particularization that one other way a servant or a slave could escape from bondage was by converting to Christianity. What this Virginia law in 1667 says is that, you know, your slave can be converted to Christianity, that's fine. They will still be slaves. So conversion is no longer an escape route from the fate of enslavement. Next slide. I'm trying to keep track of time here. Bacon's Rebellion. Okay. This is a rebellion that occurs in Virginia. Without going into what that rebellion was about, let me just say that Bacon led a militia against the House of Burgesses of Virginia that was a multiracial militia composed of white indentured servants and black slaves. This was a shock to the House of Burgesses and the planter class in Virginia. It is also perhaps the first, you know, third world movement or multiracial alliance in US history. I don't know, maybe. But it was shocking to the planter class. Next slide. Okay, so Virginia reacts to this threat of basically the threat of indentured servants and slaves uniting to attack the status quo. Bacon actually burned down on the Capitol building of Jamestown. So this was taken very seriously. So the Virginia Slave Codes of 1705, there's about 15 of these codes, but essentially they accomplish two things. One is they ensure that all Black people who are in a state of servitude actually are enslaved. At the same time, it also offers some privileges, preferential treatment to white indentured servitudes. Excuse me, white indentured servants. So this is clearly an attempt by the House of Burgesses to divide the working class, so to speak, and part of that division was the granting of white privilege to the indentured servants who were white. So for white indentured servants in Virginia after this law, not only did they get better treatment than they had received before, but their essential privilege was that they were guaranteed that they would not share the fate of enslavement that was being meted out to the Black enslaved workforce. Next slide. Okay, so this is, I don't know if I can get away with labeling this white privilege, but when I read this, it struck me as being precisely that. Not only is the owner of servants is being called upon to ensure that indentured servants have a basic livable standard of living, not that they ever received that, but at least in law they should. But more importantly, now whipping was like a standard punishment for indentured servants and slaves, but Christian whites in this particular code, if they were unfairly whipped, could actually if they were unfairly whipped without an order from a justice, they could go back and grieve that. And if found that they were unfairly whipped, they could be compensated. So I don't know if that's not privilege, I don't know what is, but anyhow, we all know that white privilege is, there's a whole cottage industry of literature being produced in the last, 5 years on this subject. But in colonial America and in US history, we can see that it's nothing new. Next slide. Okay, so going back to Coates's posing what is the father of race, and Harry's observation that race is racist. In relation to the racial distinction which Harry posits as occurring, Harry posits racial categories as being categories of a distinction that is being made in society prior to the emergence of those categories and the ideological form of those categories, race. So in preparing for this, I just looked at the material that I found online and presented in these slides. I went looking for, you know, at what point in these laws, you know, are Africans being referred to as Negroes and are Europeans being referred to as white? So I'm not saying this is the first time it happened, but at least within the limited framework of these 10 slides, the racial categories appear in this order. The hereditary slave law of 1662, this is a law that was prompted to plug the loophole where Elizabeth Key was able to escape enslavement because she had an English father. So in this law, it's an Englishman upon a Negro woman, and something bad is going to happen to a Christian if they commit fornication with a Negro man or woman. So Negro is the Spanish word for black. So that's black. In the Virginia slave codes, begins to refer as Christians or Europeans with the adjective white. Now I'm reading all over the internet that the first use of white to describe persons of a race characterized by a lighter complexion. All over the internet, you will read that according to the Oxford English Dictionary, the first time white was used in this fashion was in 1671. But, you know, that takes that with a grain of salt, maybe that I did not verify or substantiate that. Okay, next slide, please. Okay, race is racist. Harry in his article says that races appear about a century after the emergence of the racial distinction, the particularization, the hyper-descent rule, all that we have seen in the previous slides. And here comes along Samuel George Morton, and he assumes that the composition of that which we call Homo sapien is actually a collection of subspecies. I think he identified five. And that these subspecies had inherent intellectual capacity based on their cranial size. He collected, I think, tens of thousands of skulls, and he's famous for actually trying to decide which skulls, the skulls of which races had the greatest brain size capacity. And, you know, this is how, you know, science comes to the fore and provides a justification for everything that has happened to Black people up until that time, and still much of what has happened to Black people since that time. You know, although it is true, you know, that geneticists and scientists today have pretty much rejected natural theories of race, the fact that actually race is a social idea that inheres in our physical features still seems to give race the quality of being an immutable natural form of existence. And so I think when Coates says that race is the child of racism, here this notion of race is racist. It's not something that created racism, but the conception of humanity in this manner is itself racist. So I think there is 4 minutes left in this presentation. I want to very quickly jump to the end of this article on Harry's concept of the working class. He talks about working class can be conceived as a collection of Archie Bunker types, or the work class can be conceived in terms of what it is categorically. And at some point, when those Archie Bunker types come to realize who they are as members of a working class, and at that point of time, we will see a unity within the working class. And I think when it comes to the race question, across the racial divide. But as long as within the US working class, there is this hierarchy within the proletariat in which there is a high level group of proletarians that are being compensated well above the socially necessary amount to keep them alive. And while there is another segment of the working class, which is principally occupied by people of color and mainly African-Americans that are not being paid a living wage and can only make it if they're working multiple jobs. As long as that hierarchy exists and this notion among the so-called middle class, white middle class of US society, that they actually are like a miniature version of the bourgeoisie and that they have a stake, you know, in the persistence, you know, of class society in the US because they see themselves as part of the ruling class, then when their status is challenged, they do become also rapid racists. In a similar sense that when the House of Burgesses was attacked by their workforce, I mean, they were racist already, but then they went over the top, you know, with their slave code. So that kind of reaction, I think, is what we're seeing today. I just want to say, though, even 50 years ago, I mean, Harry was very optimistic about racism being overcome within the ranks of the US working class, partly because proletarianization was proceeding at such a rapid pace. Because you have to remember, in 1975 is precisely the moment in time when these so-called middle class, as Joe Biden says, good paying middle class jobs that white people had, they all got shipped overseas. And so all the stories that were appearing at that period of time was actually basically all about the disenfranchisement or dispossession of what was still largely then a white industrial working class. And so there is sort of an objective democratization of the working class taking place. And I think that it was his feeling or his hope that that would contribute to the anti-racism struggle as an objective condition of the working class as being actually more all in the same boat than it has been at any previous time in US history. So with that,
yeah.
JT and Eric, cut it short, I'll end.
Well, you know, thank you so much, you know, Paul, JT, you know, for anchoring this morning's session. You know, apologies to everyone who did the readings and if, you know, we didn't have time to discuss your questions, but, you know, I'm wondering, Paul, if you might not, when the archive, the digital archive is up and running, if you might not consider holding another event. And if so, maybe we can take our questions there.
Oh yeah, we can do that.
Okay, let's do that. You know, we have another session at 1:00 and as Stefan was suggesting, if you wouldn't mind logging off, we are going to keep this open. You certainly can, you know, stay on if you'd like to, but we will start again at 1:00. Please use the same link that you did use this morning. But yeah, and maybe some of the questions that we had about these materials, we can take to the discussion that happens later today. I certainly have a question that I'd love to pose about what Harry thought about the racism of imperialism, if he actually had a take on that, especially since he says that racial categories as a social particularization are principally intra-societal and critiqued the conflation of racial formation, national formation. But in any case, maybe we can discuss that later. Thank you all so much. I hope to see most, if not all of you, later today. Okay. Thank you, everyone. Thanks again, Paul and JT.
Thank you.